Bonsoir et bienvenue. My name is Tamarel Sheikh. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Studio Arts. Welcome to this fourth lecture in the 2015 Conversations in Contemporary Art Speaker Series. I invite you to join us for the rest of the talks over the course of the year here in VA 114. This evening's presentation by Sandra Ramos was generously supported by Miriam Rowland. On behalf of students and faculty in the Department of Studio Arts, I thank you, Miriam, for your support of the speaker series so far and into the future. To introduce tonight's speaker, I welcome the artists and SICA seminar participants, Hannah Strauss and Boris Dumenil, to the podium. Thank you all for coming.
Hello, everyone. Conversations in Contemporary Art is a visiting artist lecture series sponsored by the Concordia University MFA Studio Arts Program. SICA provides a unique opportunity to hear distinguished artists, critics, writers, and curators from the Canadian and international community speak about their practices. The visiting lecturers represent a broad range of interests and approaches and reflect the diversity and breadth of contemporary art practice. The disciplines covered include painting, sculpture, drawing, photography, fibers, ceramics, sound, media arts, social practices, and public art. I now invite Anna, who will introduce tonight's visiting artist, Sandra Ramos. Thank you.
It's our pleasure to have Sandra Ramos here tonight as part of the SICA lecture series. Sandra, who lives and works between Havana and Miami, is one of Cuba's best known contemporary artists. She has exhibited internationally, and her work is part of the collections of the MoMA, the MFA Boston, and the Ludwig Collection, among many others. Her work employs print, painting, video, installation, and more to explore Cuba's social and political realities in a global context, but through intimate textures, familiar literary and historical characters, and personal narratives. It's an honor to have you here. So please join me in welcoming Sandra Ramos.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it a lot that you are here tonight. And thank you to Concord University and to Miriam for hosting me tonight. And I hope you enjoyed the talk.
First, I will we made a little introduction of my work, and I will talk about my practice through the slides that we show some of them. My work is very personal. It is constantly nourished by my life and learning experience, as well as the things that I like and care about. It is universally in the result of the influence and assimilation of an artistic, cultural, and historical background shared on the basis of the Cuban sociopolitical context, but surpassing the two issues that concern humanity as a whole. For me as an artist, communication is a main goal. I'm interested in connect with the general public and the artistic, political, and social contemporary context worldwide. I try to establish through my art a thoughtful trace that could be helpful to people on the future to understand our world and make it better. My work is also a reflection about the everyday life in my country and about the relationship between the private and public space in contemporary life. I use the artistic practice to point out the loss of the utopian feelings and the frustration of the socialist and humanistic ideals of equality and justice in contemporary societies, and especially in underdeveloped countries. I studied printmaking at San Alejandro Academy and the Higher Institute of Art in Havana, Cuba. And my work has always been very influenced by the tradition of print and graphic aesthetic. I take advantage in my work of the narrative quality of engraving and illustration, as well as its characteristics as a reproductive media of popular distribution. I reuse an image and context that first appear in travel diaries, scientific books, magazines, and advertising. I like the surrealistic and naive quality of the old of this all by remarkable views of the new discoveries, war, people, nature, and animals. Also, many of my work have a critical and ironic approach to the indoctrinated essence and intention of political propaganda through graphic language manipulation of image. So here you can see some of the image that influenced me when I was studying at the Higher Institute of Art in Havana and San Alejandro Academy. Mainly, as a printmaker, I was very interested in the books and illustrations, this kind of illustration that it came from the tobacco industry, and also, of course, the illustrated magazine of 18th and 19th century, Japanese prints, and all the political posters that in Cuba we used to have a lot. From this, I started to work in 1989 in a series of prints that take all these image of the travel books of 16th century and the discovery of America to make comments about what was happening in Cuba in the 80s with the tourism. At that time, tourists in Cuba was just allowed, Cuban people was not allowed to go to the hotel, so it was a kind of apartheid between the image that tourists have and place that they visit and the places that Cubans could access. So for me, it was very logical, the parallel with this image of the discovery. It was like this imaginary world that tourists access that has nothing to do with the idea of what was happening at that time. Also, some of the issues that start to appear was the prostitution and the idea of dollarization of the country. After that, I create this character that you will see many of my work in 1993. It's the character of the pioneer girl. It was a mix between my self-portrait and an old print that represent a Dutch queen. And as you can see in these two images, one is from 1993 and one is for 2010, I work a lot with the idea of propaganda and how it works, and the language and symbolism of the political propaganda in an ironic way. This is, we will be like Che and Matutino. It has to do also with education, with double morality. And there are etchings and aquatint prints. In this piece, the new ideology from 1994 also, you can see the use of the symbolism and colors and ways of the propaganda to use in a critical way. This was a slogan very spread in Cuba, is study, work, and defense. And so I work with the double meaning of the study. It's a study, but people is thinking in leaving the country, the migration, work, people working for the hotels and tourism and fusil. It has to do with the defense of the country, but it has the $1 bill in the beach. These two paintings from 2008 also were with the symbolism of political representation. One is Heavyweight and Iceland Trapped by Death. For me, it's important to talk about this, about the influence of print, and also about the influence that other artists have in my work. I think usually when I make a presentation, I do it chronologically. But for this time, I think if I am in the university, maybe the most interesting thing for the student is to see where I get my inspiration, the ideas that are in my work, how they relate to the art in general. And I think that could be interesting. In this case, other artists that influence my work. I am interested in artists that through the history have a critical, cognitive, and descriptive approach to the epoch and society in which they live. I love work in which artistic experimentation and skills are in function of communication. Artists that use humor as a support of the contextual commentary and expose different point of view of the similar subject. Work that have a surrealistic dreamlike quality that explore the subconscious and the relation between mind and body. Francisco Goya, Gustave Doré, Honor Daumier, Frida Kahlo, Max Ernst, Edward Kinholz, Louis Bourgeois are among the artists I most admire and study. So here you have some examples of the work of this artist that I like a lot for his quality, the way they work with print, and the way they impact society of their time. And this is a series from I started in 2002 and 2008, in which I use all these characteristics of the irony, the caricature, and it's the title of the series is Attack Panda, and it's a series. Attack Panda was a Chinese branch of TV that government sold to the people at the beginning of 2000, trying to replace the old American electronics. And so it's the shape of the TV, and there are all comments about what is happening in society, how news impact people, the manipulation of news. And I started in 2002 and finished in 2008. So they are all the most important news in Cuba at that time in the television. And the one in the top is in the Independencia, and you can see the trace from Cristóbal Colón, America, and Russia to Chávez in Cuban society. And the other war games is from 2002 and was when the Afghanistan war. This is another piece, Five Ways to Torture My Soul and My Body. It's a series of prints, Chinanahuatin. It seems very influenced also by this tradition of printmaking and the war of Goya and Dumière. And Sea of Sorrows is part of a series in which I have a reference of Max Ernst and its collage work. It's a series in which, of course, it's related to the idea of emigration, the idea of the dead, and it has the reference to the series of collage that Max Ernst do. This also is an installation with the same idea. In this case, these kind of bins are very common in Cuba and all the house people, because people need to collect water, because they have several days without water, and then you collect in this kind of. And for me, it's, I use in this word the symbolism of the cheap break of the, as a symbol of the failure of a society. And so there are all these bins and light box installation with the rest that a cheap break or a storm bring to the shore. And this piece, this was an installation that based on Goya, of course, The Dream of the Reason, in which I, I don't know how to going back. In this installation, I use pictures that I take in the markets here in Canada and United States, and made light boxes with these pictures in the kind of tables that we use in Cuban markets. It was a time in which we almost, now there's a lot in the markets in Cuba, but in 2000, at that time, it was not so much. So it has to do with the idea of the contrast that we have in contemporary society between wealthy and poverty. It's a scene that you can find everywhere in any city, and at the same time, it's a global issue that should concern everybody. And in this case, I made this contrast between the abundance in the development countries as Canada and the scarcity in many other places. And for me, this is the dream of the reason, the idea of that humanity is still can surpass the nightmare that is the disequality. And here you have another artist that, of course, influenced my work also, Frida Kahlo and Louis Bourgeois, Edward Kinghouse. So here you have some example of installation, like this was a 1996 Island Creature, say installation with all trunks and suitcases. I painted and made a sculpture inside. and was like the treasure trunks on the bottom of the sea, but it has to do, of course, with the people who die. And these trunks are that they are like the containers of their life, the life of people who die on the sea. And this, they are a reference to the feminism, the idea that is, you can see in the work of Frida Kahlo also, and Louis Riva, of course. And it's all this idea of the woman and as a mother, in relation with the air and with the nourishing. And so one is the navel of the world, and the other is universal core. As you can see, I use a lot the shape of Cuba also in my work as part of the body. And in this case, it's a light box installation also, it's more related with the idea of mutilation and body also, the feminine figure, the use of the body, the human body. And also is mixed with the sea, that is a symbol that I use a lot in my work. This is Uterus installation from 1997 that I show in Vancouver, in Belkin Art Gallery, in Vancouver University. And it's again the same idea of this room for a baby in the bottom of the sea. Also, I have a lot of influence for everything that I learn, that I read. And in this case, universal literature and philosophy influence a lot my work. In my work are many allusions and quotes from child literature and illustration. I choose and recite characters and stories with a moral value as Pinocchio, Alice in Wonderland, Little Red Hood, and Rapunzel, adapting them to a contemporary context. I am very interested in universal literature, especially in suicide poets and writers as Anne Sexto, Sylvia Plath, Cesar Pavese, and Vladimir Mayakovsky. Classic philosophers as Seneca, Thales de Mileto, Heraclitus, Plato, and Greek mythology in general are constant references in my art, as well as Werner Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and Einstein's theory of relativity you can see in some of my work. This is an artist book. It's the Jabberwocky. Alice in Wonderland is a character that I always quote in my work. The child that is a pioneer has to do a lot with the idea of Alice and the idea of the child that don't understand the world around her. And in this case, this Jabberwocky is like a visit of Alice to Havana. It's a mirror book, and you should read, of course, in the mirror. And it's just this reference is from pictures and prints from the book. It's a mix between pictures of Havana and here you have two other examples in which I use the symbols of Pinocchio. It's the fall and generation. And in this painting, I use a character that you will see also in many of my work is Livorio and the fool and the pioneer. They represent like three different times in Cuban history. Livorio is like a farmer. It was created by a cartoonist at the beginning of the 20th century during the American intervention. And the fool was created in the 30s during the Machado dictatorship. So they represent like three times in Cuban history. Rapunzel. And these are prints that have to deal with the idea of time, the idea of relativity, and then encountering time. Time Machine and Quadrimomentum is a homage to Escher. Alone at Night, Marry My Bed was an installation, 1995, in which I base in poets that commit suicide. It's just pillows embroidered and painted, and they're all quotation from this poem. The water cycles is a piece made on mirror paper, mirror acrylic mirror in which I take the idea of Tales de Mileto, that the life is like a river that you never swims twice in the same water. So the piece is very autobiographical, but at the same time, it changed a lot when people go in front of the piece. It has to do with the idea of how your life is always changing in relation with what you learn and the people that you meet, and all this is always part of you. And this is a piece from 1999. It's Why Does Rain Look So Much Like a Flood of Tears? More relate to the relation with between nature and human being, and like the poetic representation of the feelings through art, in poetry or in visual art. This is the Road of Uncertainty. It's a video installation. And this is in Thyssen-Bornemisza Contemporary Art Collection. And it's the shape, what you see when you're in on this room is that you see the stars, the shape of the Big Dipper. And so each of the structures go to a television, so you see in each one a different video, but all the structure is covered with mirror paper inside, so the image is always like distortion, and it has this psychedelic quality, and all the videos have to do with the idea of that we don't know about the future, that we always are in a kind of uncertainty in our life, no, about what will happen. And this is from the same time, in this case is the Eyes of God, and it's a similar kind of video animation. And then of course it has to do with this spiritual idea that we are always been looking for. We are seen by somebody, you know. Gulliver is another of the reference to literature. And also music has influenced a lot my my art. In this case, I made a series based on Vivaldi seasons. This is Miami Spring. I made one for different cities. And Greek mythology also, I quote a lot from Greek mythology. In this case, this is Penelope. I always, I made a series in which I try to understand Greek Cuban society and what happened recently in Cuba, and reinterpret it through mythology. In this case, Penelope, of course, has to do with the split of the families and the people who stay in the island waiting for the family that emigrate to other place. This is Kronos, it's an artist book. Also work with mathematics and the many quotations about time. And this Searching Ithaca, also story has to do with the idea of emigration, with what migrants expect to find in these new places. And it's mainly relate to Havana and Miami, like a travel through the true cities. And Cielo Skies is based on Edgar Allan Poe, and it's more related to the idea of the dead. This Invisible Poems was an installation in 2010. This kind of tunnels, the small tunnels we have in our parks in Havana, the park for childs. So I based this piece in a poem that I love from a Cuban exiliated poet, Gaston Vaquero, and he made this book that is Invisible Poem, in which he tried to explain the past from a place to other, but also from the childhood to the adultness. And what I do was inside this tunnel where we used to run and hide when I was a child, I made like little windows with the engraving of the poem in glass. And so people go inside and read the poem and have the experience to travel inside this small tunnel. But also people can write whatever in the top of the tunnel with a white pencil. It's called Cuban culture. Is very important in my work. In my artwork, identity and Cuban culture are present in a very organic way. Cuba is an essential part of it, not only from their conceptual sustenance that is closely related with the study, analysis, and reference to the Cuban culture, politics, history, and society, but also starting from the use of symbols and elements from our context, as the island, the sea, the palm, the flag. Classic characters of the Cuban political cartoon like Liborio, Abela's Fool, and other popular characters as the jinetera, the bureaucrat, etc. I have also dedicated some series to meditate on neurotic topics of the Cuban society as the consequence of the introduction of the dollar in the Cuban economy, the tourism, the prostitution, and the historical recurrence of the dependence of... Oy, oy, oy. Why? Sorry. Historical recurrence of the dependence and colonization cycles. The migration has been another of the fundamental subjects of my engravings and installation. I used to work with suitcases painted in its interior. This tried to be a compilation of the experience, dreams, the sections, and the Cuban emigrants' illusions. The idea with immigrant stories, the open suitcase were a media of making public the private life and the social reality of the Cuban people. They tried to be a symbol of the contradiction among people, impossibility of having the total control of the objectives on their life and the desires and illusion of the migration as a solution to their personal problems. Other works approached to the topic of the imaginative representation of the aquatic world. I began to use new materials like fish balls, fish, nails, sand, establishing a representation of another island under the sea created from the rafters' death experience, a new artificial world defined by the impossibility of changing human destiny. So in 1990, here you see again the character of the pioneer. This is a series about emigration. It was the first time I touched emigration in my work, from 1993. And was based on a personal experience of my boyfriend at that time. When everybody's gone, the loneliness arrived, then communication become each day more difficult. Maybe I must divide myself in two, and now what can I hold you with? So it have all this narrative quality also that you can see in all of my work and the characters that would be a constant. This is one of the pieces in which I use the idea of the island. Is the dance circumstance of the water all around. And it's the shape of Cuba as a kind of San Sebastian. This in 1994, you remember at that time it was a big exodus of Cubans to United States. Because Cuban government allowed everybody to build this any kind of raft and go to the sea, and was a lot of people dying on the sea at that time. And I made these pieces. It was a series of work in which I worked with. And this was for the biennial in 1994. It was a series of suitcases painting inside, also with the idea. Now the migration is a topic very common in Cuban artists, but at that time was like a very new topic and was very critical for. This is a piece from 1994. It's Mirage, and deal with the same subjects. It was before the towers go down. And this series of three suitcase installation, The Life Doesn't Fit in a Suitcase, which I built these big suitcases that you can live inside. They have the mattress. I made one for a girl, one for a couple, and one for an old man. And it has to do with the people who stay in the island also, because I think I always think that the immigration don't affect only at the people to immigrate, the people to stay and wait for the news and miss the others are very important too. And so I made these like suitcases that you cannot move. It's like you put all your life inside them and become so heavy. And work with new medias as aquariums and fishbowl. It's a self-portrait, it's a recognition of the fish, which it's a portrait of my body, and it's aquarium in each part of the, it's like a room and with little furniture for the fishes. And this piece, it was my first video piece and video installation, 1999. It's machine to drown sorrows. These kind of containers in Cuba you will see in any political and manifestation, and also a party like a carnival or a public celebration, because they sell rum or beer from this kind of container. So what I do is, in the gallery, you can drink directly from the container, but inside it was covered with mirror paper again, and it was the sea just inside the reflection of the sea that is coming for a television moving inside the machine. And it has to do with the idea of the sea and the alcohol as a way of evasion for Cuban people. The sea is like the physical way to escape, and the alcohol, because we have a lot of people, a lot of alcoholism, is the psychological evasion. And this was also a video installation. Well, the title is Divers, and it's I made this in Cuba, in Mexico, in London, and it's a video, it's just video about the people who look for things on the garbage, and the people on the gallery need to the public need to do the same, to look inside the garbage tank to see the video. It's another, these are air mold mirage, and again, it have to do with the dreams of people who emigrate. I have the this animation, but I would put at the end. Well, here you have some other prints in which I deal more with the political in Cuban society. In this case, it's with the idea of the art as a way of evasion, as a way to. For people to get rid of the bad scene of life and develop a creativity, but also it has to do with the idea of art as a compromise with a society. It's a way to killing loneliness and my daily vocation of suicide. This is an island that dreamed to become a continent. I work a lot in many pieces. I work with the idea of the egolatrism of the island, the idea that Cuban we have sometimes, and it's in our political, and it's like a kind of machist idea also, that we are very different, that we are the best, that our society is like, it was like a kind of indoctrination, part of the indoctrination also in Cuba, no? It's like, we are special, and it have to do with this. And it's all Cuban history from Colón, the most important characters, to now. And it's, the title is The Island to Dream to Become a Continent. These are some of the cartoons, the caricature that represent the Fool and the Liborio. They were taken from the first half of the 20th century magazines. And this is a series that I made in 1996 when dollar was open in Cuban economy after the special period. Was the first time that Cuban were allowed to have dollars. Before that, if you were caught with $1, you can go to jail for 10 years. But after the special period and the fall of Russia, in Cuban economy needs improvement, and government allowed that people in the United States and in other countries send dollars to their families. So this is the history lesson, and it's like it's a series of eight prints, and it's always like $1 bill, and you have to do what happened at that time. And it's Liborio. This is the end of the innocence. The problem of the peso and growing miracles. This is another piece where you can see all these characters, and it has to do with a comet symbolizing the Cuban island. I made a video animation also with the same idea of this painting. And it has to do with the fragility and of the actual situation. And the utopian ruins is another subject that I bring up in my work, the idea of the ruins of the society and the ruins of the dream that Cuban revolution is supposed to be. This is learning, also dealing with education. In the country of the blind and cutting the cake. This is very, it has to do a lot also with what is happening recently, what will be the future of Cuba. Orillas del Rio Lete, it's on the banks of the Rio Lete, are the also reference to mythology, and the Rio Lete was the one that if you drink from their waters, you forget everything. And the other is the Ariana's thread. And of course, it has to do with the idea of the labyrinth, the Minotaur. And this is conversation con Proteus. Proteus was the Greek god that predict the future. And these are still from an animation. It's a relay race in which I question also about what would be the future of Cuba. Electrodaleograph was an installation I made in 2006 in which I made short videos about the main concerns of Cuba, like the transportation, money, traveling, the future for old people. And it was a kind of performance in which people lie on this bed. And then they start a video in the television, but it was with the heart, the beat of the heart. It's like trying to get the beat of the heart of the society and the concern of the society. And this also, this is very recent performance and participative installation in Havana Bienal 2015, in which I work with the idea of all the countries that Cuba have depend on, and it's the kind of cazuelas that we use in the tomato soups, and also in the parties, collective parties, and each one is with the shape of a different map of the country, like Russia, United States, Venezuela, China, and it's just give food to the people from this. Since I start to travel and spend more time in other cities, especially in Miami, my work suffered a process to adaptation to new interesting challenges, subjects, and art medias. The concept of the transitory identity and cities in displacement start to have a poetic representation in my work, establishing an unified new line. The impact of the relation between Cuba and USA and the United States and the upcoming improvement on this subject also have been represented through the use of symbolic elements as the bridge, the passport. The use of identity documents, passports, ID card, budgets, credentials become a recurrent topic in my practice for their immanence as immanence as a visual object that are essentially the human form of validation and verification of the hierarchy found in all societies. Identity cards are used by the means of political power control. The identity is diluted in a classified, uniformed, and controlled basis that aims to define who we are and limit the scope of our actions through regularization and systematization. So this is the nearest far point was an installation that I made for the Habana Biennial 2013. It's based on the void that is in Key West that marked the 90 miles, the nearest point from between US and Cuba. And it's a kind of landmark. And what I proposed was to make the same point in Cuba. And so in one side of the void, you can see the letters that are in Key West, that is the photo on the bottom, and in the other you see the letters of the place in Cuba that is in Icacos, in la peninsula de Icacos, and from the top of the void you will see the same sea, but it's the sea taken from Key West and from Cuba, but it's the same stretch of Florida. And this was an installation also in the same exhibition. It's 90 miles from 2011. And there are pictures that I take from the plane traveling from Havana to Miami. And it's this bridge that's in which so many people have died, but so many people have crossed also and have success on their life. So it's like walking on the stretch of Florida. You have Havana on one side and Miami in the world. And I for the Venice Biennial 2013, I made a similar installation, but with the idea of the cross of emigrants through from the Balkans to Italy. And it's a piece that is this is finished, but I have the idea to make a bigger installation with the idea of bridges and different part of the world. You know, now we have all the problem. The world is in constant movement, and now is the crisis with Syria. Some immigration has been always a subject, and I want to continue with this idea and make all this bridge between different parts of the world that are in the immigration regions. And the parallel roads also a piece that have to deal with this idea of the cities and the displacement. In this case, they are in one side. This is a piece that moves, and in one side is photos only from Cuba, and in the other side are photos from different cities on the world. But each time that the image goes together, then you see that there are many parallels and things that are similar in those cities, even when they are so separate. And of course, travel has been an influence in many of my work, of my paintings. And in this case, this is Learning to Speak in Manhattan and New York Shadows. And all this series have to do with the sensations and the ideas that I get when I visit a new city. And it's like a travel diary for me. This is a conversation with they are based on pictures, and then I manipulate the pictures in Photoshop, and then I paint on the top. A conversation with death and a vision of devil in Broadway. This is Alice in Vegas Land series. I know something interesting is sure to happen. Also from Alice on Vegas Land. This is Flying Miami. Miami Ukiyo, eh? Defying Electra is also the reference to Miami. And this is an installation, also light box and mirrors. It's transitory identity, and it has to do with all this idea of displacement. And there are pictures of many different cities, and it has to do with the double possibility, the possibility of crossing the bridge and being success, and the possibility of die on the The pieces have two sides, the failure and the success. This artist book, the Urban Zoo, have to do with the idea of also of Miami and Havana, but in this case, it's kind of soulization of the city, you know? The crates in the port that, to me, are similar to giraffe, and the idea of the whale that transport the city, so it and the highway as a serpent. And in the series of horizons, I start to work with the passport as a subject, and there are passports that friends send to me, in this case, a Cuban passport from people that left the country since before the revolution and to now. And so it's to show how the passport have changed through the history, but also the places where people establish their stories. And also for us, the passport is very symbolic because for Cuban during many years, to get a passport was something like almost impossible. Even now, still it's very expensive for the majority of the people. But now it's become better that people can travel. But before it was, you just travel if you get a job outside sent by the government, then you get a passport. So it was like a very precious object for Cuban to have a passport. And so this the same series. And this is with the American passport, and the title is Travel to the American Dream. It's all also like a reflection about this pre-established ideas of the American, what American dream symbolized, no? And this is a series also with the title is Havana Mirage, and they are made on mirror and engraving and print on the top of the sheet of acrylic mirror. And it's a relation between Havana and other cities in the world. Pass identity, but in this case, they are not passports, they are all documents. And it's also a travel, but more a travel in time, a travel in the history of families and rediscovering all these documents and creating like new stories from this, the information, the little information that we have in an identity document. In this case, this is also very autobiographical, it's the document that my family have when I was a child. Mm-hmm. And this is I like this document a lot because it's from the people who fought. It's the people who fought on the Ejército Libertador in Cuba during the war against Spain. So it's very old. That were the ones who create the idea of nationality and identity for Cuba and the first that fight for freedom. And it has to do also with, there are all documents from different young clubs, also the communist young party in Cuba. No? It's like the evolution of this. And this is one of the last series in which I have been working. That is, I am doing a lot of sculpture and drawings using the recycling, the lotería tickets that people buy a lot. And it has to do also again with the idea of what the people expect to find, how to solve the problems. Everybody like wants to win the lottery. But also I have a lot of reference to people who win the lottery and it doesn't work for them. They die or they lost all the money. So it has to do my work a lot with the idea of what people expect to find, where they put their hopes and what they really get in life. And so I would put a couple of videos of animation at the end, and then we start the discussion. This is relay race. I'm sorry. This is a different. That's all.
So we have a little while for questions. Thank you so much, Sandra. That was a wonderful presentation. We have a few minutes or a half an hour or so for questions. I have a microphone. I'll pass it around. Anyone wants to get us started? And if I can turn it on.
Do you live in Cuba? Like, do you want to be there? Yes, of course. Now I'm living in Miami since 2 years ago, but I have been living in Cuba too, just now. Living now in Miami because my actual husband lived there, so I moved for personal. But I never thought before that, but. Yes, of course. I'm very concerned about what will happen in Cuba and how Cuba will develop. Mm-hmm. And
I think it's many artists are, and all Cuban people worry about that.
Mm-hmm. It seems like you've. It seems like you've worked through different political periods in Cuba. Have you run across censorship issues?
Yes, of course, all Cuban, but I don't have had a directly problem with of censorship. I always had the possibility to deal with what happened. Mm-hmm. But there are many cases of censorship. Most recently was an artist named Tania Bruguera who used to do a lot of performance on the street, and we have a big problem now. Last December, for one of her pieces. Mm-hmm. But for me, I have some like bureaucratic problems, and I know that sometimes they call people who show my work and say some things to them, but not directly to me. Mm-hmm.
Does that surprise you?
No, really, because I think it for me has been like so many years working. I am very well recognized artist in Cuba, and also my work is like very ironic. It's directly, but you can interpret it. So,
you work in several different media. And it's obvious that sort of the role of artist as sort of intermediary for political and social issues and the people is really important to you, that connection between their condition and the way they're living their lives and your work. Is there any of the media that you work for that you find is most effective to speaking directly to the everyday person in Cuba for expressing or connecting with them?
Well, I think the installation where people participate, that's what I like to do this also. I think when people involve in this kind of thing, for me, it's better, and they are part of the work also scored. But the prints, the series of prints, when I see through the time, I think they also talk a lot about Cuban and what and for the people maybe is for everyday people is harder to understand, but I think in some way they understand that. But of course they enjoy more when it's a participative work. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you're so active as a printmaker, and I suppose that means that you sell your prints. Where do you sell them in?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
U.S. or do you sell them in?
Oh, in Cuba, mainly all art. They are not collectors in Cuba. Now there start some young people who start to have a small business, and they are interested in collect. But they are mainly the collectors in Cuba are from outside. Yeah.
Could you describe the piece you just mentioned of the artist who was censored?
It was it's Tania Bruguera. She's a very well-known Cuban artist, and she in 2002, I think. She made this piece that is an installation that was the Susurro of Tattling, the Tattling Whisper. She made it in the Havana Biennial in the center with Fredo Land. It was like a podium that everybody, any people, have 1 minute to say anything. And they allowed to do that in the Biennial. But now she wants to repeat the installation in La Plaza de la Revolución, in that is a place in Havana where all the political manifestation happened, and was just on December 8th,
On December 18, Cuba and America start to approach with this new relation, and this was like on December 28. So it was very recent to all this change, and I think like the government was very scared what would happen if she put that on the street. Mainly the censorship in Cuba is with work that involved on work to work on the street and involve many people. That's when it's in the gallery, sometimes there are censorship, but when it's a performance or something like that, then it's when it's more problematic to do it, because you need the permissions and all this. They don't like to work that involve many, many people. They are frail. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for showing and sharing your work. Mm-hmm. I had a question about, I guess, making political work representing the situation in Cuba. Was there always a desire or an importance for you to share that work outside of Cuba? And can you talk about how that work is received mm-hmm. sort of within Cuba, and then the difference between how mm-hmm. it's received outside of Cuba?
Well, in Cuba, it's part of, people understand very well, and it's part of their life. So they, for example, when I do the exhibition in the biennial in 2012 in the Museum of Fine Art, that was something that people like a lot, because you have the idea of the bridge that they have. It's like in the mind of the people, but they never saw a representation of that. They have the boy that also is a very important symbol for us, because almost all immigrants go there and take the picture and send to the family. So the people in Cuba and the passport and all this, and was just like before all this happened, that now it's more easy. But so for them, they enjoy this and they write me nice scenes and interesting scenes in the book in the gallery. So. And for foreign people, I think usually the public is that go to my exhibitions or they're interested in my work. People that are also interested in Cuba and what is happening there. But I think I try to see my work not also as a political or relate to Cuba. I try to that my work talk in other levels to people in general and to issues that concern everybody. I use many examples from Cuban society, but there are problematics that you can find everywhere. Mm-hmm. They're not just from Cuba. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes?
When you talk about the Cuban problematic from storytelling, mainly from Eurocentric or very mm-hmm. Anglo characters, like Alice yeah. in Wonderland and things like that, I understand how here that's a lot more palatable, like a lot more digestible, but is there any sort of reaction to that in Cuba?
Of course, because they are part of our education also.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But, there's sort of, I think it's smart to do it that way, but there's a big discrepancy of telling that story from those kind of points of view, because they're sort of like opposing. There's no, I guess I just want to
they are
to
not
know
opposing. We used to read the same books when we were a child. We don't read about Indians or Caribbeans or just European culture is everywhere. And also remember, in Cuba, at the beginning of the revolution, it was an educational revolution also, and people used to read a lot. My generation was very well educated in world, in intellectual world in general, not just since to reference to Cuba. So I use symbols from general literature, but also symbols that came from Cuban particular environment. Mm-hmm.
Yes, you do. Your you do a lot of techniques and media, and I wonder, when you have an idea, how do you choose what's best suited to express it as an installation, mm-hmm. as an animation, as a print? Or
yeah, sometimes it depends of what I... Usually, for the installations, I have very clear the idea that it should be an installation. But with the prints and paintings, and it's depend of what material I have or what I in the moment in the studio where I show you. Also, many years of the process of many years, so it's hard to say. At the beginning, I used to do a lot of prints, and I tried to, as I told you, to take advantage of the qualities of the prints and the idea of the print as a media in which you can say it's a set scenes that you're supposed to see in the public media as television and news and newspapers. But in Cuba at that time, there was not discussion of these issues in this media. So I take the print that is the old media that in which that was do before, no? And but the prints, paintings, and are drawings are I have a relation more intimate, no? More sometimes the same process and also the ideas came more from the biographical, and in installation it's more participative and you almost not see my character in the installations. No, it's not so narrative. So it depends of what I am talking about. Mm.
I would also supply that you've been working for many works with many different materials, mm-hmm. and for me it takes a long time to complete one series, and mm-hmm. I'm wondering if you're working different series at the same time,
yes.
and also how
mm-hmm.
I'd like to know your process,
mm-hmm.
and when you get idea how you can lead to the final.
Yes, usually I work with different series and different kind of sometimes I'm making an installation, but at the same time I'm making a series of prints, or I maybe have I'm like 3-4 months working in a media, and then I get boring and I start to work in another. There is not I cannot say I work in print from this year to this year, and I work in installation from this year. No, it's just like all mix. Mm-hmm. Sometimes for me it's very hard to explain my work because of that, also because there are like many different medias, many different ideas, and the appearance of the work sometimes is very different also. Mm-hmm. When you see an installation and you see a print, sometimes you don't need to think that it's the same artist. So. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Getting greasy. Do you have a particular opinion or standpoint on the developments with the relationship between Cuba and the United States presently?
What can I do? Can I say? I think everybody's hoping that this could be good for Cuban people, but at the same time we have all the concerns about commercialization, the idea of the country development and develop in a way that is very like on tourism, on things that don't improve development and quality of life for Cuban people. That is the main thing that we should try to achieve, no? Mm-hmm.
Would you say that there's a general feeling in Cuba pertaining to that?
The general people in Cuba want a change for many years, so the general feeling is hope and hope that the change will be good, but it depends. We know so what happened in many underdeveloped countries, and we see that it's not good and not perfect. And Cuba is a very poor country, so in what direction we develop, it depends on many things. No?
Mm-hmm. I really like your titles, and they seem important, and I was wondering if writing plays a part before, after, what's your relation to writing? Because the titles have a lot of power in the work, and
yes.
They sort of explain and even enrich it. Even the one you said about the eyes of God,
mm-hmm.
that plays a...
Yes, for me it's very important, the title. Sometimes I get the title first, and sometimes I have the image and so the title came, but it has to do with all this relation with literature, also with music, with I like to read a lot, and so many ideas came from that. Mm-hmm. And sometimes titles are my titles, sometimes I quotation from other people. Mm-hmm.
A follow-up to that, but do you find that the title often comes before the image?
Sometimes,
the image,
yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes.
Mm-hmm. I'm wondering about your relationship with dreams. You seem to represent dreams. The softened edges of a lot of the pictures remind me of dreams,
mm-hmm.
political dreams of escape and so on. Do you record your dreams in a dream journal and then work on them, or...?
No. No, but for me, a dream that is also a symbol, no? It's a symbol of the hopes of people, or the thing that you don't understand. All my work have to deal with that. Mm-hmm. And of course, you have all the reference to surrealistic also.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, I think in my work you see that's surrealistic, that seems surrealistic, but it's realistic, it's not surrealistic. It has to do with a reality that looks like a dream or looks not real but exists. And I think in the old world we find that. We find places that are like scenographies, like the series of Alice in Vegasland. It's like you are in a dream in something that is not real. It's really not real, but exists. and you find this everywhere, no? It's like, and you see in a scene in the street that is totally surrealistic. Also, you can find that, but it's realistic.
You referred to many artists who influenced your work. Did you see work of those artists in Cuba, or did you travel in order to see them?
No, when I study, I never saw real work from this artist, but I studied them in my classes of this art history, all that. And after I travel, of course, I have seen many, many places. But all the influence came from when I was studying, mainly. I think that is when you get the base of everything that you will develop later, no? When you are young and you are studying something.
So it was from books rather
yes.
than from the actual
yeah.
work.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Could you say more about your studies and what the state universities had in mind for artists?
Yes, when I studied art, I started to study art in 1983. I was 12 years old. At that time, the school of art in Cuba were all the school. The education in Cuba in the 70s, 80s was very good. It was very the government was very focused on providing a good education, and it was more material and at that time, also because Cuba was supported by Russia and socialist countries. And
there was this school that is the elementary school of art where child apply. You made a text and you at that time, and then they choose some child to study art. That was in visual art, also in music, in ballet, and then I was there like 3 years. After that, you made a new test. I studied at the San Alejandro Academy. That was media level, but was more focused on academy at that time. The school was more focused on that you learn the techniques, drawing, painting, print, sculpture. But even at that time, it was in the 80s, and the 80s was very important moment in Cuban art. Because it was a moment in which artists start to make more experimentation, start with installation. Also because 80s was the first time that the Cubans that are emigrate were allowed to in on the country again. So there was the influence of people who left Cuba when they were childs in the 60s, and they back and they bring information. And some of these people were artists as Ana Mendieta. I imagine you know this artist, very well, Cuban. And they bring this information about what was happening in the world outside, in the artistic world, the installation, the performance, the land art. And this influenced a lot the young generation that were my teachers at that time. And also they started to become critical and approach to subjects that were not touched on to this moment, like religion, that was many artists as Jose Bedia and start to work with subjects related to religion. There was a subject not allowed in society. Of Cubans, we were educated ateos, and religion was at that time, like, even if you feel for any job, you need to feel if you have family outside Cuba, and if you have a religion, that's something that won't help you, if you to get a job or to get a good school. I remember when I was a child, that kind of questions. But the artists in the 80s start to work about this. I studied, they were my teachers. And after that I studied at the ISA, is the Higher Institute of Art in Havana. It's a very beautiful school, and was very was a place where young artists start to get a love of exposure and work in many new ways, and was a good moment to study there. Many of this generation from the 80s and the 90s. They were very critical also about Cuba, left the country at the beginning of the 90s, in 1992. It was the special period and was a big exodus of artists from these generations to United States and Mexico and Spain. It was like a gap. And then the young people that were studied there, like the people of my generation, the 90s, were presenting for first time the work that we were doing in the Havana Biennale in 1994. But was because not all the teachers, they all have left. So they invite their own artists because they don't have nobody else. So imagine you are studying your last year in the university, and then you are invited to the Havana Biennale, to the Biennale that was the most important event in and was a success, this biennial, for all the people of my generation. It was from that you were invited to many other.
Post-graduation goal?
And now it's very interesting also what is happening now with this new laws in Cuba and the relation with the United States, because it's not only the relation with the United States have started since 2 years ago, 3 years ago, since Raul get the power, he started to make some change in Cuba. As the first change was that Cubans were allowed to go to the hotels
because to 2010, I think, 2008 was the first time that you as a Cuban can go to a hotel with pay with your money and stay in a place where all the foreigners stay. Also, now Cubans are allowed to travel outside of the country without the permission from the Cuban authorities. That's another different thing. Now Cubans can have small business, like little restaurants and rent in your house. And also you can buy and sell houses, that's new. So there are like small improvements that are important for the life of the people. But what will happen with the economy, the economy in general, we don't know, because the island have not industry now, just the tourism.
Mm-hmm. How are you doing, Sandra? Can you take another question?
Yes.
We have time for one.
Well, it's more of an easy question, but as an artist, what is like your favorite part, like in the doing of art?
Good question. I think every part is you enjoy when you are alone in your workshop producing, but what you enjoy a lot when people go and see your work or participate in your work. For me, one of the pieces that I made that I enjoy most, it was not here, was a performance because I don't do performance. I do work in which the public made I don't perform myself, but they are part of the piece, no? And was we have in Cuba a procession to San Lázaro. It's African. It's a mix between the Spanish religion and African religion, and it's every 17th of December in a town near Havana. And during 3 years in 1990, from 1999 to 2001, I was going there and taking pictures, because it's like, very, there you see the things that you never see in your life. It's like very poor people, but also like very fanatic. And for me, it was very weird that in a country where you're supposed to have education and health and seeing that, then you see the problematic of the real society. And I made these pictures, and then I made 12 light boxes, and in the next procession, the following year, with the pictures that I take there from people, and there are people that go every year and put it in the wall of the 8th hospital that is in the road of this procession. San Lázaro has to do a lot with the health, with the people who is sick and all this. It's very medieval. You see people in the floor, like very weird. And I put these light boxes in this wall. And the reaction of the people to this piece was one of the, in this procession that has nothing to do with art, and people who usually never go to a museum or a gallery, or was one of the things that touched me more. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, join me in thanking Sandra for making it all the way here.
Thank you.